Penguin Random House Audio presents Second Wind, A Sunfish Sailor, An Island, and the Voyage That Brought a Family Together. This is the author, Nathaniel Philbrick. Author's Note. I never thought I would have a midlife crisis. As far as I was concerned, all of life was a crisis. To point to a single event as the defining moment of one's middle age was either a baby boomer's self-dramatization or, at the very least, wishful thinking. Doesn't the word midlife imply that you've got more than a few good years left? I've now come to realize that the events described in this book, all of which occurred between the spring of 1992 and the fall of 1993, constituted, if not a crisis, a kind of watershed. Before that year, I was a stay-at-home dad who only got out of the house to take my two kids to the playground. While I considered myself lucky to be with my children every day, I had lost almost all touch with sailing, a sport that had once meant everything to me. Then everything changed. For reasons I'm still trying to understand, I decided to take another shot, maybe one last shot, at the Sunfish Championship I'd won 15 years before. I began an odyssey that led me from the lonely ponds of Nantucket Island to a humbling return to competition in Florida, then down the Connecticut River with my family, before I headed out to a steamy lake in Illinois for the North American Championship. In the end, it brought me home to Nantucket. That all this happened while I was working on a history of the island called A Way Offshore, a book that tells of a place experiencing its own midlife crisis, makes me scratch my ever-lengthening forehead and admit that, well, maybe its author was having one too. Now, 25 years later, my wife Melissa and I still live on Nantucket. Although I have long since donated my sunfish to the island's community sailing school, and we recently traded our beloved beetle cat for a more comfortable Herreshoff 12 and a half, we still sail every chance we get. Our daughter Jenny grew up to be a highly competitive laser sailor and was a member of a nationally ranked sailing team in college. Our son Ethan, never a serious racer, has become the most adventuresome mariner of us all, whether it's circumnavigating Cape Cod in a small cruising boat or dodging the tugs on the Hudson River in a J-24. Just last summer, I'm happy to report, Melissa and I took our two-year-old granddaughter Lydia on her first sail across Nantucket Harbor. Many of the books I've written since the publication of Second Wind in 1999 are about America's relationship to the sea. This is the book with which I explored my own relationship to both salt and fresh water, and I hope you enjoy the voyage. Nathaniel Philbrick, Nantucket, April 2017. Prologue. My children glared at me. What they saw was pathetic. Their 36-year-old father watching television on a weekday afternoon. It wasn't Oprah or Geraldo or Donahue. It was worse. I was watching the America's Cup on ESPN. The thing of it was, I hated the America's Cup. Having grown up racing little sailboats on little lakes, I had nothing but contempt for what the announcers kept calling the holy grail of sailing. To self-styled purists like me, the cup was more about money and ego than wind and water. If there was an essence of sailboat racing, the America's Cup had moved about as far away from it as San Diego was from Newport. Then what was I doing in front of the television? The kids wanted to watch the Mickey Mouse Club, but I wasn't about to surrender the remote control. As a parent, I could decree it was my turn, not theirs. The race might not even be close, but I was going to see the finish. It was a contest of wills, and I was going to win. "Dad," said 9-year-old Jenny, "get a life." "Yeah," added 6-year-old Ethan as the two of them turned and headed out the door. "So there." I tried to concentrate on the television screen, but something nibbled at me, made me shift restlessly on the couch as the two giant yachts glided across the nearly windless Pacific Ocean. Maybe it was time for some fresh air. The kids had gone off to play frisbee in the backyard. They had already forgotten about the scene in the living room, but I hadn't. Although they let me join their game, it wasn't long before my attention drifted toward the side of the house where my old yacht, a dirt-encrusted sunfish, leaned against the foundation. If an America's Cup boat is a Ferrari, a sunfish is a VW bug. Some would not even call it a sailboat, just a piece of recreational equipment. Real yachtsmen like Sir Thomas Lipton and the Vanderbilts wouldn't have been caught dead in a sunfish. The boat is so mundanely bourgeois that John Updike used one to kill off his middle-class archetype, Rabbit Angstrom. But to me, a sunfish was more than a water toy. It might be ugly, an ironing board hull with an isosceles triangle sail, but a sunfish is fast. When I sailed a sunfish for the first time at the age of 14, after 2 years of poking around in an 8-foot pram, I felt like I had traded a paddle boat for a torpedo boat. No wonder Jack Kennedy sailed these boats. There's even a picture of him on a sailfish, the sunfish's even more humble predecessor, sporting the same grin he flashed from the bridge of PT-109. The notion of racing a sunfish might have struck even the classy JFK as absurd. It's low to the water, it's wet, it's undignified. But for me, in 1970, a teenager in desperate need of an escape from all the land-based problems of the world, there had been something elemental and all-consuming about a sunfish. Nothing could compare to the exhilaration of a close race in a real blow, the wind howling and the spray flying as my sunfish and I punched through the waves to the finish. But on that spring afternoon in 1992, sunfish racing seemed about as irrelevant to my life as the America's Cup. Instead of a sailboat, this sap-spattered fiberglass hull, unused in more than a decade, looked like a beat-up luggage pod waiting to be clamped to the roof of a minivan. By that point, I'd abandoned Frisbee and was standing beside the sunfish. Eventually, the kids wandered over to see what I was up to. "Give me a hand," I said. I grabbed the sunfish's gunwale. Jenny took the stern, and Ethan wrapped his little fingers around the handle at the bow. Together, we lowered the hull onto the grass, right side up. What had been nibbling at me while I watched the America's Cup turned into a stabbing pain in my gut. Scribbled across the deck in grease pencil were the compass headings from my last big regatta, the 1978 North American Championship, the highlight of my sailing life, when at 22 years of age I had eked out a narrow victory over 178 of the most competitive sunfish sailors on the continent. Although I had sailed and even raced the boat a few times since then, I had never let myself erase those hieroglyphics with their mystical significance to my golden age. A car pulled into the driveway. It was Melissa, my wife, the kid's mother, returning from a day at the office. Jenny and Ethan ran up to greet her, and soon all four of us were staring at the sunfish. "What are you going to do with that?" she asked. Melissa had also been a sailor. In fact, we had met as sailing instructors at a yacht club on Cape Cod. From the beginning, however, there had been profound differences in the way we approached the sport. Although Melissa had been an extremely talented sailboat racer, who had finished second in the 1981 Women's Sunfish North Americans, she never seemed to take it terribly seriously. Sailing was just one of the many things she had done well as a teenager growing up on Cape Cod. For me, on the other hand, sailboat racing had been more like a personality disorder. By some cruel twist of fate, my father's search for tenure as an English professor had marooned our family in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, but that only made me more stubbornly committed to becoming a world-class sailor. Whether it was on the Monongahela River or a man-made lake, I spent just about every weekend jousting against my younger brother Sam in a sunfish. In high school, I was one of 3,000 students and painfully shy. In a sunfish, however, my inhibitions dissolved. With a main sheet in one hand and a tiller extension in the other, I attacked each race with a passion that only my brother and my parents truly appreciated. During the summer of 1974, my fervor grew to include a girl named Melissa with blonde hair, blue eyes, and a sunburned nose. And on a cool, foggy night in August, we ended up together in the cockpit of her family's Beetle Cat, the same kind of 12.5-foot sailboat in which both my parents had learned to sail a generation earlier. An 18-year-old misfit from Pittsburgh felt as if he'd finally found the place where he belonged. The following year, Melissa and I, by then a confirmed couple, drove out to a sunfish dealer in Springfield, Massachusetts. After an unsatisfactory fling with a flashy Olympic-class dinghy, I had decided to return to the boat that had given me my real start. Although Melissa was sometimes bewildered and even frightened by the way I acted around sailboats, she had come to regard my behavior as a kind of insanity that, if not treatable, was at least temporary. That afternoon in Springfield, however, everything was delightfully calm as the two of us wandered hand in hand through a yard full of brand new sunfish in search of the perfect hull. 17 years later, here we were, assembled around the same boat. Needless to say, it no longer looked perfect. "Why don't you ever sail it?" Jenny asked. It was a good question. Not long after Jenny's birth, I had made the decision to pursue a writing career at home. Life became a blur of doctor appointments, diaper changes, deadlines, and rewrites. The prospect of doing anything that did not somehow revolve around writing or around the schedules and needs of Jenny and Ethan became unimaginable.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.